about remarks on non-singular black holes. Please.
We have early morning in Edmonton, so good morning, everybody. I would like to thank organizers for opportunity to speak at this remarkable conference and to give a talk. I will be speaking about what is called non-singular black holes. In 1965, Penrose proved his remarkable singularity theorem, and later this result proved originally for black holes was generalized in many different ways by Penrose and Hawking, and was also applied to singularities in cosmology. According to this theorem, which is implied to the black hole physics, this implies that general relativity does not give us complete, consistent description of space-time inside the black hole. Exact solution of Einstein equations describing stationary black holes give us more understanding what kind of incompleteness you can have. In this case, you have curvature singularity for Schwarzschild black hole, Kretschmann tensor, Kretschmann scalar growth as inverse sixth power of radius. So singularities exist both in cosmology and inside black holes, but they are quite different. In homogeneous universe cosmology, while tensor vanishes, and the curvature singularity is connected with the growing of Ricci tensor. But according to Einstein equation, Ricci tensors are connected with the stress energy tensor, and you can exclude the singularities but by simply modifying the equation of state. For black holes interior, does not work. The problem is that for Schwarzschild solution, Ricci tensor vanishes. So what we have growing while square, which means that we have fast growing anisotropy, and modifying equation of state does not help us to solve this problem. So what happens inside the black hole? Near the r equal to zero point or line, we can introduce proper time, which is the time and remain up to the big crunch, and metric near singularity can be written in the form shown by the green formula. This is nothing but contracting Kasner-like anisotropic universe. The slice tau equal constant is a space-like slide, and it has topology S2 cross S1. S2 are connected with the angle variables, and R is connected with the coordinate T, which is a space-like inside the black hole. So this tube is shrinking in two dimensions and is expanding in one dimension. So how to prevent curvature growing? So there is a natural mechanism which may help. So we know that anisotropic curvature results in the production of the particle in cosmology. For example, when weak field in weak field approximation, Zeldovich and Strabinsky proved that the rate of particles creation is proportional to C square. So in the one loop, you have effective action which contains both curvature square and non-local terms. The problem is that it's very difficult to obtain reliable theory which describes everything in the strong field regime. One can also modify gravity. So why modify fundamental gravity? Introduce high derivative, consider F of R theory, consider non-local modification such like Ghost free and so on. So everything of this was the subject of the many talks at this conference. One also, also can consider the option when gravity is an emergent phenomenon. It happens in string loops and so on. So in this case, when the curvature becomes very high, the classical description of space-time terminates, and instead of this, we shall have something like a new phase of the constituents corresponding to this theory. In this talk, I consider completely different approach to these kind of problems, what can be called phenomenological approach. So I assume a number of reasonable assumptions and try to find out metrics which satisfy the properties I would like to have. So first of all, I assume that there exist fundamental lengths, which I denote by L, and this length is much larger than the Planckian length, so that I consider my geometry as a classical geometry described by some modified effective action. So something happens similar in cosmology because you have inflaton field with a mass much smaller than the Planckian mass. In the domain when the curvature is less than fundamental one, metric are based Einstein equations with small corrections. In the domain where curvature becomes of the order of critical one or fundamental one, Einstein equations should be modified. And I also impose one additional assumption which restrict our analysis in many ways. This is what can be called limiting curvature conjunction. So I assume that the theory is constructed in such a way that it prevents curvature higher than something proportional to our fundamental one. So curvature invariants should be restricted by some dimensionless quantity C divided by L square, where C is a dimensionless universal constant which defined by the theory. And it's independent on the parameters of the solution. This point is very important. So because what we expect to have at least for large masses, something like black hole solutions. And this solution contains one parameter of the black hole. And this parameter can be changed by accretion of the matter and by the Hawking evaporation. What I would like to have some models for which for any value of this parameter, curvature is restricted by some fundamental value. This principle was formulated a long time ago by Markov in 1982. My goal is to study some non-singular black hole models and try to find out their robust predictions. So when I speak about curvature, I will have in mind quadratic and curvature invariants, so wild square. So also introduce the tensor S, which is a traceless part of the Ricci tensor. And I consider scalar S square, and also I consider Ricci scalar R. So the Kretschmann invariant can be written as a linear combination of this quadratic and curvature invariants. So in spherical symmetric case, it's possible to show that if this S square vanishes, Einstein tensor can be written in terms of G mu with the coefficient of proportionality proportional to the Ricci scalar. And if R is constant, you will have something like deSitter equation for our field. I will use this result later. So let's consider the general form of spherically symmetric metric. I use advanced time coordinate, which allow me to consider regions inside the black hole. This is advanced time coordinate V, and I use radial coordinates R. And this metric has two functions, in general case function of two variables, alpha and F. F is the square of gradient of R, and alpha in static spacetime connected with the norm of the Killing vector. At infinity, we assume that our spacetime is flat, and we normalize time to be equal to the Killing time. So this gives us asymptotic value for F and alpha to be equal to one. If at some domain we have a property that F can be equal to zero, this domain with restrict the area, some domain where F is negative, this is the boundary of this domain, and this boundary of this domain is known as the parent horizon. So if you calculate Kretschmann invariant, so it contains in terms shown in the green color, and from this relation, you can conclude that apparent horizon cannot reach center of our space-time, r equal to zero, without formation of the singularity. If invariants of the curvature are finite, you can write expressions for f and alpha at the origin, which are shown in the blue color. So So I assume that curvature invariants are finite, and moreover, they are uniformly restricted, and I'll call these black holes models, solutions, or metrics, non-singular black holes. So we consider the first static non-singular black holes. So it contains two arbitrary functions of one variable. So the function alpha is the relation between the rate of time at infinity and rate of time at r equals zero. We put it in our analysis alpha equal to one, and in our papers with Andrei Zelnikov, we analyze what will be the changes of this analysis when alpha is not equal one. It's not so important for my talk. As for the function f, I make the following ansatz. I assume that it's a ratio of two polynomial of a coordinate r. The reason for this is the following. All known solution, vacuum solution of Einstein equation describing black holes, for them you can find out coordinates in which metric coefficients are rational functions. In spherical symmetric case, it will be ratio of two polynomials, so I restrict my analysis to this case. So evidently the power of these polynomials should be the same because we need to have asymptotically flat space-time. So for Schwarzschild metric, n is equal to one, but it's a singular. Can we escape singularity if we take another value for n? So the answer is the following, that if n is less than equal to, you cannot do it. Metrics are singular and they cannot be simultaneously regular and have flat space-time limit at infinity. So for n equal to three, situation is more interesting. It's possible to have non-singular black hole metric. One of this example of this metric was found by Hayward in 2006. The metric coefficient for this metric F is one minus two M R square divided by R cube plus two M L square. So there exists also a modification of Hayward metric, but Hayward metric is the simplest one. So I focus analysis on this kind of metric in my talk. And details for other metrics can be found in the paper I referred. So this metric can be rewritten in terms of dimensionless variables, coordinates x. So when I introduce mass parameter m small related with the observable mass of the black hole m large, and in terms of this dimensionless coordinate x, function f is written in the following form, one minus beta minus one and multiplied by x squared divided by one plus x cubed. And beta is dimensionless coefficient, which is small for large mass black hole. So this picture shows the behavior of function f. And you can see that there are two kinds of situation. For subcritical case, when mass is smaller than some critical one, there is no apparent horizon. And for mass larger than the critical one, we call it supercritical regime. So there is a two points of apparent horizon. External horizon located at R plus for large M is close to the Schwarzschild radius, while internal radius, radius of internal horizon is close to the our critical length, fundamental length L. So this picture shows that for small mass, there is no black hole for this kind of metrics. So one can conclude that there is a mass gap for mini black hole production and this kind of models. And it's quite robust prediction and it's quite generic feature of these non-singular models of the black holes. So what about curvature invariants? So I can construct quantities which are square root basically of the square invariants. And to make them dimensionless, I multiply them by L square. So it remarkable property of this metric is this parameters, these quantities does not depend on the mass explicitly anymore, and they depend only on dimensions coordinate x. And another remarkable property, if you make mass time dependent, the expression and for this invariants remains the same. So how these invariants behave? So the external horizon, its coordinate x, so located far away from unity, and inner horizon is located close to zero for small value of x mine. And in this domain, both while tensor and S tensor become zero. So you have isotropic space, and since S vanishes, you'll have cosmological-like, deSitter-like equation of state, and R reach constant. So for this metric, you have the following properties. This metric satisfies limiting curvature condition, and in this metric, we have deSitter-like core at the center. So what about time-dependent metrics? So we assume that black hole are based Hawking type of evaporation. There is emission of outgoing radiation in the black hole exterior. Conservation law implies that there must exist also energy, negative energy flux, incoming energy flux in the black hole. Inside the black hole, you can have incoming energy radiation. This basically radiation connected with the partners of the Hawking particles emitted outside. So we can try to describe this incoming radiation in a very simple manner, try to use a description in terms of incoming null fluid. So let's look what happens in this case. So let's consider static spherical symmetric background, and let's consider null fluid, incoming null fluid in this metric. So we can introduce not only advanced coordinate V, also retarded coordinate U, and this U constant and V constant surfaces are null surfaces. Their gradients are null vectors, and for incoming flux, we have T mu nu proportional to rho multiplied by L mu L nu, and for outgoing flux, we have rho and mu and nu. So conservation law allows us to find out expression for the density of null fluid rho. It's some constant divided by 4 pi r square. And if you consider the square invariance for the stress energy tensors separated for in and for out fluxes, we obtain zero because it's null fluid. But if we have two fluids incoming and outgoing simultaneously, we can find out the corresponding invariant is non-zero, and it has very important property that it contains F square in the denominator. So it will have very important consequences. So in general relativity, if we have incoming radiation, one can consider back reaction of this incoming radiation, and the result will be Vadim metric. And Vadim metric can be obtained easily from static solution by simply changing mass depending on V. So null fluid in this metric is absorbed by singularity, and there is no outgoing null fluid, and corresponding invariant for stress energy tensor squared is zero. What happens if you have non-singular black hole? So consider incoming radiation, which enter the inner region inside the inner horizon. You have asymptotic, you have Euclidean, almost, you have regular space-time there. This radiation can cross R equals zero without any problem. And after this, it becomes outgoing radiation. So in the interior of non-singular black hole, incoming null fluid generate outgoing radiation in the inner domain. So when you have both incoming and outgoing radiation near the inner horizon, you will find immediately that you have divergence for this matter. So it means that stress energy tensor for this matter infinitely growing near the inner horizon domain. So test field approximation does not work. And for this reason, this invariant is infinite, limiting curvature condition should be violated. So this effect is very similar to the famous mass inflation discussed by Israel and Poisson. This is a mass inflation increasing near the Cauchy horizon inside rotating and charged black holes. So what happens in Hayward metric when you have incoming null fluid? It's also, you can include this back reaction somehow modifying the mass, making it time dependent. So in this case, you obtain metric which is time dependent. And for this metric, the square of corresponding tensor, Einstein tensor squared, this tensor remains finite everywhere. It's uniformly bounded and there is no outgoing radiation. So if this model is valid, you can conclude that inside the Hayward type non-singular black hole, there exists a core of some condensate with a density 1/L² and the deSitter-like equation of state. And the main property of this core is it totally absorbs incoming radiation. And namely, for this reason, there is no outgoing fluxes and it's possible to escape violation of limiting curvature condition. Now let's consider evaporating black hole with a non-singular black hole model. So mass of the black hole is changing with a parameter of advanced time V. So in this diagram, we have V in horizontal line, radius R in the vertical line. So at some moment of time, we can see the situation when a black hole forms. In simplest case, you can consider collapse of thin massive null shell. So two branches of apparent horizons are created. And during the evaporation, this horizon shown by the black lines, this is external horizon and this is the inner horizon. They becomes dynamical. So the external horizon, because mass is decreasing, becomes smaller and smaller. And there is a increasing of the radius of the inner horizon. So if mass becomes small or disappear, these two horizons meet one another. And there is an endpoint of our horizon. So beyond this point for smaller mass, there is no apparent horizon at all. So this incoming rays shown by the blue black line. So in this coordinate V, it just follows the line V constant. After it passes through the center, it goes to the direction of inner horizon, but can never cross it and becomes closer and closer to this. It can appear in the external world only after complete evaporation of the black hole. So red arrows show the lines representing outgoing radial radiation. So you can see that there is some tiny skin near the apparent horizon from where this rays can escape to external world, but the main part of this light rays, outgoing rays, go to the center and wait until the black hole evaporates completely and after they can escape from this. So one can see that in this case, the horizon has a form of O-shape form and it's closed. So if we consider the four-dimensional space-time, the topology of apparent horizon will be S1 cross S2, something like torus. So in this case, there will be no event horizon and no black holes in exact mathematical meaning. So in this black hole, there is no loss of information. Everything which is captured inside the black hole returns back to the exterior observer and return time is connected with the time of operation of the black hole. So strictly speaking, it's not a black hole, but technically it's black hole for a very long time until it's radiated completely. So during all the evolution of this black hole, the Hilbert metric possesses the property that its quadratic curvature invariants remain uniformly bounded, and the metric obeys this limiting curvature condition. So the conformal Penrose-Carter diagram for these black holes is practically the same as we pictured in our old 40 years old paper written with Gregory Wilkowski. So what happens near the threshold point where horizon disappears? So there is a critical value of mass M star and radius R star, and condition that two horizons join means that F and prime first derivative of F should be vanished at this point. We can assume that the mass is close to the critical one and radius is close to the critical one as well. And equation for apparent horizon give us relation between the mass function mu and deviation from the critical value R star. So the surface gravity for this case will be proportional to square root of this mass mu of V. So we can estimate the rate of change of the mass applying the standard formula. So the rate of change of mass due to the Hawking evaporation, its surface area of the black hole multiplied by the force power of the temperature of the black hole. So if we assume that at this stage, the temperature of the black hole proportional to the surface gravity and use our expression for mu, we obtain that function mu has a form shown in the blue formula, and mu goes to zero when V goes to infinity. So formula for this solution, we obtain the time of operation black hole is infinite. In fact, these two horizons become so close together at some moment of time V that small fluctuation can destroy apparent horizon. And instead of this, we shall have some remnant. In any case, this result indicates that the time of evaporation can be much larger than the Hawking one, for example, to be M4 instead of M3. So suppose parameter mu becomes slightly less than zero. So there is no apparent horizon anymore. What kind of geometry we have in this case? So we consider slide T equal constant. And for subcritical metric with small mu, we can construct embedding diagram for this geometry. So this embedding diagram shows us that there is a region where F is very close to one. And this region is some kind of throat. And for mu very small, its duration, length of this domain is proportional to logarithm of mu. So what is the meta content for this remnant? Suppose we have time-like slice. Suppose in our case, it's T equal to constant. Unit vector orthogonal to this slice is U, proportional to the Killing vector. And we can introduce the proper mass density, epsilon, which is T mu nu multiplied by O mu on nu. So if we substitute instead of T mu nu Einstein tensor, we have the following expression for some effective mass density corresponding to our model. So for slightly subcritical metric, there are two mass aspects. First of all, we can integrate the proper mass density with a redshift factor. This gives us mass, which is shown in the red color, and integration shows that this is the same as the mass M of the solution. Is mass of the black hole or remnant at infinity. But we can also calculate the proper mass without redshift. So this proper mass will be proportional to logarithm of M, mu, and it can be large for this remnant if mu is small. So what is the final stage of operation in this model? We can have complete evaporation and black hole time life will be large. but also we can have situation with a new universe formation inside black hole. How it may happen? So consider this subcritical solution, and this is embedding diagram. And what may happen that it, because of some fluctuation, there will be a reconnection of this point of space-time with this, and you obtain a closed vault inside the black hole. So in this case, you will have closed universe formation inside the black hole. And this kind of situation is similar to what we considered sometime a long time ago in the paper with Markov and Remnant and Mohanov. So since my time is almost over, I will need to say a few words as a summary. So there are some robust properties of non-singular black holes. So in this kind of black holes, the standard property is the existence of inner branch of the parent horizon. For complete evaporation of black holes, the parent horizon has torus-like topology, and on the RV plane, it has shape or shape, so it's closed. And also there is a mass gap for mini black hole production. So for this particular case of Hayward model, we have situation when the limiting curvature condition is satisfied, not only for static black holes, but for black holes with arbitrary dependence of mass on the advanced time V. So in this situation, we have some kind of absorbing deSitter-like core. There is no mass inflation, and it's possible to have joint type remnant. Certainly, the open question is, what are effective modified gravity equations which have non-singular black hole solution? So this is the end of my talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your very beautiful talk. And so now we have time for a couple of questions. I see Francesco Di Filippo. You can ask. Okay.
Thank you. Actually, just about this slide. So when you say no mass inflation, can I ask you why? I didn't get, I mean.
Okay, so I will just, okay, so. I need to return. Okay, so the thing is that for this kind of models with the time dependent mass in Hayward type models, we have the property that all the curvature invariants are restricted.
Okay.
Technically what happens when you consider incoming radiation, it's absorbed by the core. So all the incoming particles are absorbed by this core, and it's no outgoing radiation. The problem of mass inflation is a situation when there is two fluxes which meet one the other. So the outgoing radiation propagating outside in the vicinity of inner horizon, it has a very huge blue shift. And the particles which are members of incoming radiation, when it meet these particles with the extremely huge blue shift, they will, after collision, they will have huge mass in the center of mass frame. So if it happens, you will have mass inflation. But since our core is absorbing, there is no, in the inner part of the black hole, outgoing radiation. This is a property of this model. So this is the one of the way to escape mass inflation.
I don't know, because so the core is completely absorbing, and this I agree. But you will still have, I mean, if you assume that these are not this solution for a gravitational collapse, you will have both ingoing and outgoing radiation. They will cross outside the inner horizon, not inside.
So the key role is this kind of prediction is that I assumed, make very strong assumption, limiting curvature condition. So
okay, mass and so
will violate this condition. So any model which is considered by condition automatically will solve this problem. So the problem of to find out some effective theory which provides this condition. So this is
so this result. So I completely agree, but this is an assumption.
Yes. Right?
So there is no dynamical model that does that.
Yes, I agree. So, but we are looking for options, what may happen. And it happens that if the model provides you with a finite curvature, mass inflation will be excluded in this model. And it solves the problem.
Yeah, but this is a by assumption, let's say. So it will be very interesting to find a model that does that. But
Yeah, sure.
Okay, let's go to the next question from Anupam. You have a question?
Yeah. So thanks, Valeri, for a very nice talk. So I have a question. So the core has some states, some quantum states. So in some sense, can I think about this core to tunnel outside the, can it not push exactly like the way we think that how the apparent horizon pushes and reaches the event horizon? So can't I now think about this core, which also forms the apparent horizon, pushes and closes the entire black hole, or as it now it will not be a black hole, but some kind of like a compact system?
Okay, so this is a very good question, and it's connected with the model you proposed with Luca. But there is an obstacle for this. There is an inner horizon. So matter in this model cannot cross inner horizon until the black hole terminates its existence, because everything inside this region surrounded by the apparent horizon is falling down to the center. So the best what can do this core, try to expand to this inner horizon, but it never can cross it without reaching superluminal velocities. So for this reason, you cannot think that this core will explode and until it's something a causal happens. So this is one of the options that you violate causality in large domains. In this case, you can find out expanding with the superluminal velocity, crossing the trap region domain and going up. But it will be violation of causality in the large scale. So for this reason, in the more classical description, it will not happen.
Thanks, thank you.
Okay, so maybe now we can have